Good evening, Rowan. It's the 8th of April 2018, and it's about 10 p.m. And obviously this is my usual Sunday evening video to reassure you that I haven't been seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. In fact, I haven't even seen any priests over the weekend, but I won't go into all of that again. So, I haven't been hanging around the Catholic parish of St Urban's hoping to bump into any pretend astrophysicists in order to save your skin. And I haven't come out as a lesbian either in order to save your gigantic ego. So everything is exactly the same as usual. Nothing ever changes. Anyway, I thought we could continue our chat this evening about the lectures that you gave earlier this week, the 4th and 5th of April 2018, at Fuller Theological Seminary, which is about 10 miles from the centre of Los Angeles. So it's quite important to set the context that we just have a look at what these lectures are about. So here we are, the 2018 Peyton Lectures. So let's scroll down the page. Theology and Human Rights, Tensions or Convergence. So remember that. Theology and human rights, that's quite important. So there we are, April 4th and 5th, 2018, and this was live streamed on YouTube. So here we are about the event, and you can see Fuller Seminary welcomes the Right Reverend Rowan Williams, 104th Archbishop of Canterbury, as the 2018 Peyton lecture. So these are definitely the lectures that we're talking about. So about the presenter here, let's go down a bit. So here's the schedule then. Wednesday, April the 4th, 10 a.m. so that's 6 p.m. British time. Human rights and human identity. So let's remember that, human rights and human identity. And the overall theme of the lecture is theology and human rights. That's quite important, as I mentioned. And so Thursday the 5th of April, so I'm talking about something that you said in the question and answer session on the 5th of April after this lecture, Right Recognition and the Body of Christ. So you can see here, the second line down, this is kind of an abstract of the lecture, I suppose. Theology establishes that every human subject, every organic and spiritual individual is recognised by God as maker and redeemer. So theology and human rights, this is what we're talking about. So this is quite important to set the context of this video.
So a theological approach to rights might begin with an understanding of what creation itself entails as it's depicted in Jewish and Christian scripture. And it's filled out further by our understanding of redemption in Christ. God releases in creation that gift which is acceptable to God, the gift which is God's own love for God, passed through the medium of created selves, above all, of course, the created self in which the Word is incarnate. And this Trinitarian pattern is the framework within which we need to pursue any theological explanation of rights, human or otherwise.
All right, another question. The founders of the American Republic were keen to delineate God-granted rights first and foremost to protect citizens from excesses of government. So in that light, please comment on the relevance of this concern as it relates to your vision of human rights, and in particular, on the relevance of the protection of property rights, another early American preoccupation, and whether there is any theological basis for such a set of rights for the purpose of securing material blessings for rich and poor alike. So I'm focusing on rights, but property rights.
Thanks a bundle, everybody.
So that was the question, and here's the first part of your response. Interestingly, the focus on the priority of the sacredness of private property which appears in some Catholic social teaching as well as in other contexts, is a slightly surprising development. A very modern one, that someone should be protected from the illicit confiscation of what is lawfully theirs, seems fine. It only seems fine then. Somehow reifying that as a protection of private property, as if the property owning were the essential mark of civic dignity, I've got some worries about the way that might. So, I was quite surprised to hear that the focus on the priority of the sacredness of private property, which appears in some Catholic social teaching, as well as in other contexts, is a slightly surprising development and a very modern one. Because here we are, looking at the Ten Commandments there. That's from the book of Exodus. They also appear in the book of Deuteronomy in the Bible. The numbers there are verse numbers, not the numbers of the commandments, obviously. So Christianity is a revealed religion, and the Ten Commandments were revealed by God to Moses, and enshrined in them is a respect for private property. So we can look at the commandment there, you shall not steal, and then further on, you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbour. So here we have, in the most authoritative statement of ethics revealed to human beings by God, according to both Christian and Jewish teaching, that there is, I suppose you could say, a sacredness then about private property, the respect for private property and property rights. You shall not steal, and you shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbour. And a couple of other commandments we can see there, which you don't seem to have any regard for either. You shall not commit adultery, and you shall not bear false witness, and you shall not murder, because all your lies have led to wars starting and people being murdered. So there we are, enshrined in God's revelation. Remember, this lecture is about theology and human rights, enshrined in God's revelation to human beings, written in the Bible, is a respect for property rights. So I'm struggling to see why you call this a modern development. Right, so let's have a look at something that Jesus said now on the subject of private property and property rights. So here we are in Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 17 to 22. So, as he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal." So, let's just stop there for a moment. So, the young man asks, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And one of the things that Jesus says to him is, "You shall not steal." In other words, you shall respect other people's property rights. You shall respect private property. So let's just read on a bit from that. So this is what he tells him to do to inherit eternal life, to keep the commandments. "You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honour your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. So let's notice that Jesus doesn't say, "Well, I'm going to take all your money off you by force. I'm going to tell you to go and lecture the government to take other people's money off them by force. I'm going to remove anyone's property by force and redistribute it." He doesn't say that. He tells him to go and do that willingly. So, before you say another word on this subject, you've got a lot of property, Rowan. More than one house, at least two houses you own, and you're living in a third one. So why don't you redistribute your property instead of hanging on to all this private property? You're always talking about how people should be proud of paying more tax, and we need global taxes, and we need higher taxes, this kind of thing. Why don't you give all your surplus income and surplus property to the government, Rowan? If you think it's such a good thing that the government should be owning everything and that people's property rights shouldn't be respected. And let's not forget, you said that it was a very modern idea. It was a very modern development, a surprising development, a very modern one, that there should be this sacredness, the priority of sacredness of private property. And here we have it. We've got it in the Old Testament. God reveals the Ten Commandments to Moses. You shall not steal and you shall not covet your neighbour's goods. Anything that belongs to your neighbour, you shall not covet. And then Jesus saying, you shall not steal. And for Christians, Jesus is God incarnate. So this is coming from God directly. And of course, God revealed the Ten Commandments to Moses directly as well. You shall not steal. You shall respect private property. In other words, you shall respect other people's property rights. So why on earth are you saying that this is a modern development when it's there at the beginning, right from the horse's mouth, so to speak? Right, so that someone should be protected from the illicit confiscation of what is lawfully theirs seems fine. Well, that's good. So do you think I should be protected from the illicit confiscation of my property and livelihood? And you also want to confiscate, so to speak, my right to control my own body, my ownership of my own body, because you want to dictate not only who should have access to it, but also what I think about that, and you also want to control who I want to have access to it. And you've been trying to force your own perverted agenda on me because you've created an identity for me in your fantasy world, and you're trying to illicitly confiscate my control over my own body and my own life. So it's hardly surprising that you don't respect property rights and private property when you don't even respect someone's right of ownership of their own body and the control of access to that. So I control access to the place where I live, and people control access to their own homes. You don't even think I should be able to control access to my own body or even have an opinion about who I might like to have access to my body. You have to dictate all of that. It's quite astonishing. So in fact, your subversion of the idea of the respect of private property and property rights, and hence your lack of respect for people's private property and property rights, is simply an extension of your predatory nature. You think you should control, own my body, and you think that other people shouldn't be able to control their own property. You think control and ownership of property should be in the hands of the government, despite the fact that you've got a massive surplus of property and don't show any sign of giving control of it to the government. This is simply predation. You've got a predatory attitude to the bodies of others, and you've got a predatory attitude to the property of others. So that someone should be protected from the illicit confiscation of what is lawfully theirs seems fine. Somehow reifying that as protection of private property As if property owning were the essential mark of civic dignity, I've got some worries about the way that might take us. So I don't know who is doing that. The essential mark of civic dignity. Well, respect of private property and property owning may not be the essential mark of civic dignity, but it is certainly an essential mark of civic dignity. There are other essential marks of civic dignity, for example, a person's ownership of his or her own body. Therefore, crimes against the person, like violence and sexual violence, are prohibited in natural law, as is the illicit confiscation of other people's goods, because private property is also recognised as a mark of civic dignity. So you say, I've got some worries about the way that that might take us. So what are those worries then? Why don't you explain? In fact, you do give what I think is one of these worries right now, and you say, and you end up with, if you like, the stout independent citizen fiercely defending his, and it usually is, his front garden against the armies of a predatory state. So what's wrong with that then? Somebody fiercely defending their garden against the armies of a predatory state. And this is quite literal, actually, defending your front garden against the armies of a predatory state, because a huge amount of money that is heisted from citizens through taxation is used to pay for armies to go and fight in foreign wars against peoples who are no threat to us whatsoever. So if you're resisting that, then you quite literally are defending your front garden against the armies of a predatory state, because the welfare state is in fact only an excuse to tax the people and to stop people protesting so much against taxation, because they think that their money is going to some good purpose. But the real purpose is to be paying off fictitious debts to globalist banksters, which have been created out of nothing through the creation of fiat currency. So that's what a large part of money heisted from citizens through taxation is used for. And another thing is pointless foreign wars that only serve to further the agenda of the very same globalist banksters. So fiat currency and foreign wars are the main reason for taxation, and both of those things have been engineered by the same criminal cartel, and that criminal cartel is what we might call your puppet masters, Rowan Williams. So the stout independent citizen fiercely defending his front garden against the armies of a predatory state, and that's not a helpful model, as I was trying to suggest. You didn't actually do much suggesting of that in your lecture, so I don't know whether you're talking about what you've said earlier in the answer to this question. So you then go on. We need, I think, a stronger sense of how states work with the grain of intermediate natural communities, how states work with the grain of cooperative venture. So who needs this stronger sense then? Is it the state, or is this the propaganda that you're presenting to citizens of the state to try and brainwash them into thinking the state is a good thing, the state is taking care of them, the state isn't any threat to them, they need to keep paying their taxes, otherwise the world's going to go to pieces. I mean, who needs this stronger sense? We need, I think, a stronger sense of how states work with the grain of intermediate natural communities. What on earth are intermediate natural communities anyway? How states work with the grain of cooperative venture. So that we don't simply say that characteristic modern standoff, individual and state. So is that a characteristic modern standoff then? Well, there have been empires in the past, but in the West, until quite recently, the state didn't really exist, did it, in the form that it is today? I mean, nation states are a very modern thing, and were only arising around the 16th century. So power was much less centralised before then. You had monarchs and princes and dukes and this kind of thing, but they sort of ruled over more local areas, and so the nation state was arising around the time of the 16th century. So that modern standoff between individual and state in the West has come about because the state didn't really exist as such before then. So you then say it's true that a lot of 18th century thinking about this does turn on protest against what was seen as a predatory state. So you're talking in the context of American independence, really, which came about resisting taxation from Britain, America, the United States previously being a British colony. So this is the context. A lot of 18th century thinking about this does turn on protests against what was seen as a predatory state, but I think we should want to dig further back than that to find a little bit more about those natural forms of human association in which we discover that there are goods which are nobody's property but are only goods when they're shared. So if we dig further back than this 18th century protest against the predatory state, and we find those natural forms of human association in which we discover that there are goods, etc., etc., then where does the state come into this if we're digging back further than this standoff with the state and finding natural forms of human association? Well, the state isn't a natural form of a human association. So families, tribes and voluntary associations between individuals and families and so on, those are natural forms of human association, but the state is something that is imposed, so it's not a natural form of human association. So what are you actually saying here? So we've got the 18th century standoff between the individual and the predatory state. And I think we should want to dig further back than that to find a little bit more about those natural forms of human association in which we discover that there are goods which are nobody's property but are only goods when they're shared. Well, what on earth are you talking about? What are these goods that are nobody's property but are only goods when they're shared? What are you talking about? It sounds like you're just making this up to me. And you don't actually specify, so we're all left wondering. And it sounds like you're coming out with some brilliant insight here, but it doesn't actually mean anything, does it? What are the goods that are nobody's property but are only goods when they're shared? What are they? And you then say, and that's something we really have let slip off the radar, I'd say. I don't think it was ever on the radar, Rowan. I think you've made it up. So I thought we could have a quick look here at Leviticus 25, because you talk about going back to look at earlier. So I thought we could just have a quick look at Leviticus 25 here, because you talk about going back before the 18th century to look at earlier forms of natural association. So Leviticus 25 is talking about property ownership in the Bronze Age. So that's quite a long time ago. It's in the Bible, so it's part of the revealed Word of God. We've already looked at the Ten Commandments and what Jesus said about how to inherit eternal life, and we've seen that according to the revealed word of God, as understood by Christians and also Jews in the case of Leviticus and the Ten Commandments, according to the revealed word of God, then private property rights are to be respected. So here we are looking at property ownership in the Bronze Age. So that's quite a long time before the 18th century. So let's have a look at what it has to say. So, in this year of Jubilee, you shall return every one of you to your property. Now note that, to your property, you shall return to your property. When you make sale to your neighbour or buy from your neighbour, you shall not cheat one another. When you buy from your neighbour, you shall pay only for the number of years since the Jubilee. The seller shall charge you only for the remaining crop years. If the years are more, you shall increase the price, and if the years are fewer, you shall diminish the price, for it is a certain number of harvests that are being sold to you. You shall not cheat one another, but you shall fear your God, for I am the Lord your God. You shall observe my statutes and faithfully keep my ordinances, so that you may live on the land securely. Yet the land will yield its fruit, and you will eat your fill and live on it securely. Should you ask, what shall we eat in the seventh year, if we may not sow or gather in our crop? I will order my blessing for you in the sixth year, so that it will yield a crop for 3 years. When you sow in the eighth year, you will be eating from the old crop. Until the ninth year, when its produce comes in, you shall eat the old. The land shall not be sold in perpetuity, for the land is mine. With me, you are but aliens and tenants. So I've chosen to read this chapter because you've repeatedly referred to it to suggest that it promotes communism, and saying that people don't own the land because it can't be sold in perpetuity, but in fact the land belongs to God. And in fact, it actually says the opposite of what you're suggesting. What it's saying is that people own their land so absolutely that they can't even sell it in perpetuity. After a certain number of years in the Jubilee year, the land reverts back to its original owner. It doesn't go to some centralised body, to the state, to be distributed evenly between everybody. And the purpose of this is so that people are not deprived of their ancestral lands permanently, because when you're living in an agrarian society, then it's very important that you can grow your own food, that you've got the land there to be growing your own food. And then maybe there would be times in the life of a family when there weren't so many children and there weren't so many people to farm the land, they didn't need as much food, so they could sell a part of it temporarily, sell a number of harvests to someone else who needed or wanted more land, and that wasn't permanent. The land would revert to them after a certain number of years when they could then farm it themselves or perhaps sell a number more harvest, depending on whether they needed the land or not. So people owned their land so absolutely that they couldn't even sell it in perpetuity. And this is what it means when it says that the land belongs to God. You can't deprive people of their land permanently, because that would have serious implications in an agrarian society. And you've repeatedly referred to this chapter, and I'm going to show some clips in a minute, suggesting that it promotes communism and that God doesn't want people to own land. Well, I've demonstrated that the respect of private property and property rights are inherent in the Jewish and Christian tradition, and this is the revelation of God to us, because Judaism and Christianity are revealed religions, so this is the revelation of God, according to Christian tradition and Jewish tradition, that private property rights are to be respected. So Leviticus 25 does not promote communism, but you've repeatedly suggested that it does, and I'm going to show the clips of this now.
That's where I'd want to go back to the Hebrew scriptures and the concept of Jubilee that you mentioned. And it's been sort of dusted off and deepened in discussion in the last couple of decades in the ways we've heard. And essentially, it's a system of amnesty in cycles of 7 years and cycles of 7 times 7, 49 years. There is essentially a debt amnesty. And this is laid out in some detail in some of the books in Hebrew scripture, particularly in Leviticus. And since you may not all instantly have this at your fingertips, let me just pick out a couple of details from the discussion there, because I think there are at least four principles in the account of this in Leviticus, four principles which are of real substantive value in thinking these issues through today. Second principle is a very radical one indeed. The land, which is the source of economic wealth and security in that pre-modern society, the land doesn't belong to anybody. The land itself is on loan to you from God. It's not a possession. Therefore, you are all already indebted in some sense. And to treat the possession of land and property and disposable wealth as if it were absolute possession is to misunderstand the whole nature of your humanity in a world where you are dependent on what you haven't made. This is a world in which you are dependent on what you haven't made. You're always, in that sense, indebted to start with. And in Leviticus, God says very firmly, I own the land. That's to say, you are all having the use of the land for a period. And when you're trading what you think is property, what you're actually trading is use. Practice. The practice of wealth production. It's a habit. It's a human practice. It's not based on absolute ownership. So there are four rather interesting principles, I think, and I don't think they're just relevant to the Bronze Age in the Middle East. The very fundamental one, ownership is never absolute. We are all dependent in advance on what we didn't make and don't possess. There are several passages in Scripture we might talk about here, but I'll pick up just one or two of them. That means that our attitude to the world around us, just like our attitude to other persons, must never be one of possession. We don't own. We are given, but we don't own. So, for example, if you look at what's said in Leviticus, in the famous chapter 25 about the Jubilee, you'll see that there's a prohibition on the absolute sale of land. You don't sell each other land forever because the land isn't yours. God says, as a matter of fact, the earth is mine. The earth is the Lord's and all that fills it, as we heard earlier. The earth is mine. What you're selling, says Leviticus, when you exchange contracts about land, you're selling a certain period of use. You're selling a series of harvests. You're selling part of the process of sustaining people and keeping community alive. But you're not owning something which you transfer to somebody else's ownership. God has lent the land to us, the earth, so that we may feed each other. Not as something which we simply seize and squeeze dry. The awareness that we're to grow into, the global awareness, is crucially that awareness of living in a world we don't own and don't control. And if you like, the great opposition in the spiritual life is between an attitude of possessiveness, grasping, and delight and contemplation, on the other hand. The more we can get towards the delight and contemplation, the better. the more we're growing into God's delight in the world. The more we slip towards grasping, squeezing, ownership, the further away we move from a faithful lifestyle and a lifestyle in which we are growing towards God. So those are a few of the basics I would want to play in to this discussion about climate change as a matter of faith. Our response to the crisis of climate change, to the needs of those most at risk in our world from a changing climate, our response, if it's to be a response of faith, needs to be a response informed by all of that sense of letting go, of stepping back from ownership and control, learning to look at the environment with something of God's eyes. Because if the majority of scientists are right, part of the problem, that's part of the process that's brought us here, is generations of possessiveness, grasping, and therefore unfaith, looking at ourselves and our world with eyes other than God's. Back to Leviticus, you know, God has given us the use of the land, not as a possession, but as something we use in order to nourish a community. And that's what we have to keep in focus, I think.
So, faithfulness is indivisible, you could say. If we're going to be faithful to the human creation, we're called to be faithful to the creation overall. And it seems to me that that particular theme is one which can make sense in our congregations as we talk about it, because it drives us back to those basic, profound stories and texts which make up the scriptural record. They point us back to the God who sees creation and says it is very good. The God who promises never again to destroy creation after the flood. The God who in the law of Moses lays down that the land shall not be anybody's property forever, because this earth, this material stuff in which we grow things, on which we build things, is just lent to us. The land is God's, and that means that nobody has an absolute claim of possession over it. That has its own implications and a long story there too. But it means at least that we've got to learn to regard the very stuff on which we stand as something other than our property, something other than what we can just stuff into our pockets and take home for our private purposes.
So that's the end of my video today. And obviously I shall be going to sleep very soon to be dreaming about my beloved all night long, because he is so wonderful and we're made for each other. And we just can't wait to be together on our bed of roses, on our silk sheets, having a really good time, in each other's arms, resisting tyrannous authorities. Just me and him and his magnificent acrobatic feet. He'll be keeping me very happy. He's so handsome and gorgeous and wonderful. He's nothing like you at all. And of course your wife will be looking forward to being with her hot, sexy Rastafarian boyfriend as well. So I shall leave it there, but don't forget to be alert, because now you're back in the UK and you were in Leicester this evening, but the photos of you there were so terrible I haven't shown any because you were in the distance. So you're back in the UK, so I will be turning up to make a citizen's arrest for terrorism. and to ask you those awkward questions that I still have up my sleeve. I'm sorry I didn't text any to you in Los Angeles, but never mind, I can turn up in person and ask those questions. So be alert. Hasta la próxima.
Interestingly, the focus on the priority of the sacredness of private property, which appears in some Catholic social teaching as well as in other contexts, is a slightly surprising development, a very modern one, that someone should be protected from the illicit confiscation of what is lawfully theirs seems fine. Somehow reifying that as the protection of private property, as if property owning were the essential mark of civic dignity. I've got some worries about the way that might take us. And you end up with, if you like, the stout independent citizen fiercely defending his, and usually is his, front garden against the armies of a predatory state.
Slowly, we're catching up with an issue which we've allowed to drift because of this assumption deeply entrenched that tax is an alien imposition. Somebody out there is taking our money, and thank you, robbing us of our goods, rather than seeing it as just part of the circulation of blood in the body politic.
On my orders, coalition forces have begun striking selected targets of military importance to undermine Saddam Hussein's ability to wage war.
And you end up with, if you like, the stout independent citizen fiercely defending his, and usually is his, front garden against the armies of a predatory state. And that's not a helpful model. As I was trying to suggest, we need, I think, a stronger sense of how states work with the grain of intermediate natural communities, how states work with the grain of cooperative venture. So that we don't simply see that characteristic modern standoff between individual and state. It's true that a lot of, particularly 18th century, thinking about this, does turn on protests against what was seen as a predatory state. But I think we should want to dig further back than that to find a little bit more about those natural forms of human association in which we discover that there are goods which are nobody's property, but are only goods when they're shared. And that's something we really have let slip off the radar, I'd say.
I talk a lot of shit and practice what I preach.
Hands up, little monsters, I love you, New York! And late that night when the Lord came home, inquiring of his lady, oh. The servants said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsies, oh.
The footman analyzed the number, but the prince still holds both the slippers. A new Geneva palace for a bed sits in Canterbury Tales.
Sex.
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.
With the raggle-taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.